Let's get things started with opening statements, and going in alphabetical order, we begin with Kelly Cooper.
Thank you, Ted. My name is Kelly Cooper. I am a Marine Corps veteran, service-hearted, and have served all over the world as a Marine. I'm a small business owner that's been responsible for the creation or support of hundreds of jobs, not only around the state of Arizona, but specifically rooted in Congressional District 4. I've been married for 11 years to my beautiful wife, Erin, and we have two amazing children, Kennedy and Mason, that attend local public charter schools. The reason that I'm running for Congress is because the systematic dismantling of the American dream has been going on for a long period of time, and it takes someone of my caliber, experience, and knowledge to be able to address that. I would like to be able to make sure that I can protect the American dream, not only for this generation, but the next generation to come.
All right, thank you very much. And we turn now to Jerome Davidson.
Hello, Arizona. I'm Jerome Davidson. I'm a father, grandfather, former Arizona State running back, former Oakland Raider fullback. But today I stand before you as a pastor, one who has served close to 30 years. And I'm running for Congress because we are at a true precipice. We are at a crossroads where our policies, the failed policies of our politicians have failed us. But not only that, we are in the midst of a very spiritual and profound spiritual battle between good and evil. And I believe that evil has landed in the hearts of many of our politicians, and it's time for a change. Arizona needs a champion, one who has fought on the gridiron, one who has fought in the spirit realm in prayer, and one that is concerned about your needs. Make no mistake about it, I'm the only one on the stage tonight that has the courage and the conviction to stand before you and stand up and face our problems face on. My commitment is to God and to you, Arizona, that I will make sure that your needs are taken over first. We will close the border, lower the price of gas, lower the cost of rent, and make sure that your needs are first. I'm Jerome Davidson, your champion.
Thank you very much. And now the opening statement from Dave Giles.
Hello, my name's Dave Giles. I'm running for United States Congress here in CD4. I come from a Christian patriotic family that I was raised with. My father dropped out of eighth grade to enlist in World War II. He fought in every battle all the way up through all of the islands until he was protecting the aircraft carrier in Nagasaki Harbor that was protecting the hospital ship that was protecting or taking care of the people. I've had training overseas, domestically, locally, internationally. I have a Bachelor of Science in Electrical Engineering, so that I am technically competent. I have an MBA, so I have business. I worked for the largest oil company in the world, Saudi Aramco. And now I have my doctorate in theology. I plan to follow our Constitution precisely. And go ahead.
Okay. Okay, very good. All right, thank you very much. And now the opening statement from Dr. Zudi Jasser.
Thank you. The stakes could not be higher. We have a country to save. My name is Dr. Zudi Jasser. I'm a physician in primary care. I've been taking care of patients and families in the Valley and in this district for over 25 years. I was a Navy veteran, served for 11 years as a Navy officer in Operation Restore Hope and as a physician to Congress. And I'm the son of Syrian immigrants. We are on the edge of a cliff brought to by one of the worst presidents, if not the worst president this country has ever seen, and by the rubber stamp of Greg Stanton that has sat on his hands and has been completely out of touch with the families when it comes to the economy, when it comes to the border that's hemorrhaging, bringing in drugs and crime. I'm running for Congress because I have run into the fire for this community. I have been countering radical Islam and been countering terror groups, not only domestically, but globally. My family's been threatened by terror groups and governments across the world. And I'm here to bring this fight for you and fight for you in this district and to bring back American values.
All right. Candidates, thank you very much. Mr. Cooper, we'll start with you. The current Congress is considered, in many respects, as among the least productive in history. How would you change that?
Well, I think you're absolutely right, Ted. The current Congress has been a picture of dysfunction for a long period of time. The constant infighting, the constant lack of awareness for what's affecting all of the people in the districts that these folks represent. And it's really time for a change. How do I plan on changing that? The truth is, we have to go in there and build coalitions of folks of like mind that want to work together for the people that they represent. We have to root out the folks that are really about self-interest, that are only interested in making sure that they can buy their own stocks and drive up their value in their stock portfolios or whatever special interest is going to fund their next campaign. It's time for us to have representatives that are focused on true heart service in making sure that we're representing the people. And I think the only way to do that is to coalition build. It's a member of 435, 535 if you count both houses, and you can't do anything alone. So it is about bringing people together. I think that's important across the district, across the state.
Mr. Davidson, a dysfunctional Congress. If you're elected, you go back there. How do you change things? What do you do?
Well, yeah, first of all, you gotta go in with an offensive plan. Unlike my opponent, I really think we can actually affect some change by ourselves, like Marjorie Taylor Greene. She's shaking some things up like Matt Gaetz did when he recalled McCarthy. So listen, we can go in there with ideas. I'm going in with some weapons. I'm going in with some fresh ideas to protect freedom and to also fight for the American people. We got to get these folks up off of their seats and start fighting for America. Doesn't matter who you're voting for nowadays because there is a uniparty. The Republicans are the Democrats and the Democrats are Republicans. But I want to go in and show America a difference. And the difference is going to be is that I'm going to focus on your needs, not Ukraine, not any other nation, not the illegals, but we're going to focus on your needs. How do we take care of you, the American people, the citizens? And that's what we don't have in Congress. We don't have people who are focusing on the American citizens. And it's very frustrating because I've knocked on hundreds of doors getting signatures and talking to people, and people are profoundly hurt and harmed by the people that we send to Congress who refuse to represent us. They're more concerned about Ukraine and other wars, but I'm going to go in and I'm going to represent you, America.
He actually asked you how to solve the division, not further perpetuate.
Well, the division is going to be the division. And listen, it's going to be a division, right? If these people are talking about putting money to Ukraine, there's going to be a division with me because I don't want to send any more money to Ukraine. We sent over $200 billion to Ukraine, and we haven't even got an answer as to how it was spent. So, yeah, there's going to be division as long as these people want to give our money to other people and money to illegals. But if we want to unite, well, then we're going to unite on the needs of the American people. That's how I'm going to deal with it.
All right, Mr. Giles, how do you make Congress a little better than it is right now in terms of getting something done?
Well, we could start out with some term limits. But really, the reason I'm doing this is because I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. Since I was a kid, we've seen people go to the Congress. They say they're going to do one thing. They get bought. They get paid off. They go to Congress, and they get wealthy in Congress. But when the wealthy men go there, they're arrested. We got to change Congress and not just roll over like they've been doing, like this continuation that's put on. I'd say no. And they're going to have to learn to live with a no and put America's first. Our veterans are in trouble. We have people that are homeless. We need to bring stuff home. And here we go. We got this thing here called the Constitution. Nowhere in here does it say we need to send aid to any other country for any reason. I intend to follow the Constitution, support what's in it, do not support what's in it. And look at the 10th Amendment, folks. If it's not specified in here or denied in here, it reverts back to the states or the people. So we got to keep, when you go to the federal, all going to the federal government, whether it be Senate or Congress, we need to follow this. And that's part of the premise that you got to stop sending money to other people. We got to stop earmarks. And if you notice, the Department of Education's not in there either. We got to get that back to the states and to the people and to the parents.
Dr. Jasser, I'm hearing a lot of issues, and we're going to touch on most, if not all, of those issues throughout the debate. But I'm looking at pragmatism here. I'm looking at getting something done in a Congress that is almost historically now stagnant. What you going to do?
And Ted, this is exactly why I'm running. You know, I ran a business for 25 years, small business in healthcare, and have stayed in private practice because I was successful in doing so and yet pushed back against the establishment. I have a track record of pushing back against the establishment in my faith community and successful in changing the narrative nationally from about terrorism to about political Islam and the ideology, and also in healthcare against the weaponization of government against patients, against families, and against businesses that were shut down. Most of the people on this stage are either perennial candidates or actually supported the lockdowns. And I, as a physician, Kelly supported the lockdowns. And I, as a physician, did not support them, said that things that were being done to businesses that were something more akin to what my family left in Syria, then should have been allowed to the choices for families here. I've also been very successful as a bridge builder. I'm the only candidate on the stage endorsed from the diversity of Senator Kyle to Charlie Kirk. In my candidacy for Congress, from Glenn Beck to Hugh Hewitt nationally, and also locally with Sal DeCicco and others. So that proves that I'm able to build bridges within a conservative community to have effectual pragmatism moving forward. And I think nobody else on this stage has showed that type of activism and showed productivity in the work that I've done as an activist and as a small business owner in the last 20 years.
All right, Mr. Cooper, respond.
Yeah, I'm actually shocked at how little you know about the district and how little you know about what went on in this district. For the last 3 years, all three of the rest of the men on this stage have fought for this district and worked hard. The accusation that I stood up for the lockdowns is not only false, it's actually ridiculous. I spent every single day, 6 days a week, cooking to-go orders for people so that they had food at home. I bought toilet paper to hand out for people in our community so that they had toilet paper when they couldn't find it at the store. So the accusation that I stood up for lockdowns and just capitulated to government overreach in this district is not only ridiculous, it shows how much you know about this district living in North Scottsdale.
Mr. Davidson, you want to get in this?
Well, I just want to say, we don't even know where this guy came from. I mean, you know,
we know where he came from, North Scottsdale.
Well, here's the deal. Talking about fighting and talking about changing and activism, I'm the only one on the stage that went to January 6th in support of President Donald Trump, in support of our First Amendment right to petition the government over what we felt like was an unfair election. So, yeah, I was fighting. I was at the tabulation center. I'm at the protest. I'm at the pro-life. I was at the pro-life event yesterday for the vote. These guys were not there. This doctor was not there. So his activism, he's been doing that stuff on TV. But boots on the ground, Pastor Jerome Davidson has been doing that.
Okay, I can't let this go. I can't let this go by real quickly. What were you doing there on January 6th? What did you actually do?
What was I doing there?
Yeah, what did you do when you were there on January 6th?
I held a sign. I cheered for President Donald Trump. I walked to the Capitol, but didn't go in. I was shaking hands with people, meeting and greeting. I didn't go in. I didn't do anything, didn't harm anybody. But I did ask a lot of people in masks and in helmets and stuff, what are they doing there?
The hypocrisy of Mr. Cooper saying that he did not say that, it just is, it's a mischaracterization. On a podcast on Medford, he said that he was for the lockdowns, and also the hypocrisy of saying that he serves the community through his business when my business has served thousands of patients and families in the district.
In which
absolutely.
In which community?
Hold on. The Valley, in Tempe, in Mayfield, within
which
the community.
I'm sorry, where is your doctor's office?
Hold on, Mr. Cooper, please let him finish.
Where's my doctor's office? Yeah. In Phoenix. The district includes a third of my patients live in district, sir. So you can mischaracterize and try to deceive. And by the way, the issues people care about, the families I talk to, the thousands of families I talk to care about is the border, the crime, the economy.
You're
they're
right.
Paying. They have to make twice as much money.
Hold on
they have to make twice as much money in order to buy a house. That's what they care about. If Kelly wants to care about my home address, you know, that shows where his priorities are.
All right, Mr. Giles hasn't gotten in here yet.
I did not get the jab, so how much I support that COVID process.
Do you think that Republican voters, and this is a primary, Republican primaries are focused on them right now, do you think Republican voters in this district want to send to Washington someone who refused a vaccination for what turned out to be a pandemic?
Well, it's, yeah. They're not going to accept government overreach to come down and tell us what to do, mandate mask. We all know that the mask just plain out didn't work. They don't stop the virus from coming through. And you're getting jabbed, people end up being more sick than they were when you get the jab. I'm perfectly healthy, and I'm one of the special elderly or over-age group people that are, I've had a collapsed lung, I've had a heart valve put in. I got three cases where I'm most susceptible to get it, and I didn't get the jab, I won't get the jab.
Real quickly, for those in the district who've lost loved ones, who know of neighbors and friends who either died or are seriously affected by COVID, what do you tell them?
I don't know what to tell them. I mean, if they got the vaccination, did that kill them? If they didn't get the vaccination, did that not get them killed? I don't know. But we know, technically speaking, you know, the Fauci guy is run out because, you know, yeah, you got to do it today. No, you can't do it today. Well, it's different. Now do two masks instead of one. Where does this stuff end? Government overreach has got to stop. Government overreach is beyond this.
Okay, Mr. Davis, please.
So I had a question for the doctor. He said that he served 1,000 people. You said you served thousands of people.
Thousands of families, absolutely.
Oh, thousands of families. But my question is, was that for free or was it for profit? Did you make any money off of these people that you say you served? Because as a pastor, I serve for free. I serve my community for free. I'm at their houses praying for them, laying hands. I'm at the hospital. I'm at their gravesite.
I'm running a small business, sir, that includes insurance. I have an insurance-based practice. that has my fees fixed. So if there's anybody that understands the stress of the economics of patients, is the fact that I have a fixed fee schedule while my payroll, everything goes up. Okay. I write my check last.
So the answer
in
is
my
yes.
Practice.
The answer is yes. He did profit off of that service.
That's called an income. That's called making a living.
Exactly. Sir. Of course, it's called profit
so
as well.
So you really don't understand what it is to run a business.
It's called a profit.
So you're admitting to the American population
I'm admitting that you said that you serve. That's not service.
My service is on the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom. My service is countering radical Islam.
We were talking
Islam
about the thousands of patients that you said.
Mosque,
you said you had
the
thousands
mosque,
of patients.
Mr. Davidson, please let him respond.
The Tempe Mosque imam gave a sermon that there was a doctor that was against the community and part of the Zionist conspiracy. I was so much countering the radical ideology happening within our Saudi-funded mosque in the Tempe at ASU that I became the subject of many sermons and attacks from radical groups, Muslim Brotherhood groups within our district. So yes, I served our community.
All right, so
that was
very
service.
Quickly, please.
But the people that went to his doctor's office and was charged, that was not service.
Mr. Cooper, what we're hearing a little bit here is what we're hearing a lot of on Capitol Hill. And the question is, Republican voters in this district, is that what they want?
No. No, they don't. They don't want what's happening here. They want what every one of the rest of us, including you, want. You want safety and security. You want peace of mind when you go home. You want the ability to live a happy life. You don't want all the division and distraction. You don't want the arguing and bickering. You want people that are going to go to Washington, that are going to work with the people that are willing to work with them to move legislation forward to make your life better. It is that simple. There is nothing more to it.
I want to move on to the economy here, and Dr. Jasser, we'll start with you. The economy is on a hot streak right now. We haven't been 20 years since we've seen 2% expansion for this long a period of time. There's also inflation, and that is a concern as well. What do you make of the economy, and how would you handle economic issues on Capitol Hill?
Well, I'm sorry, Ted. I'm not sure which narrative you're listening to. When I talk to the families, 2% expansion almost sounds, you know, the CCP recently said that their economy expanded. And the socialist type economy that we have now is just not expanding. It is inflationary. We printed money like it was going out of business. And that has, I'm not even an economist. And as a doctor, small business owner, I can tell you that if you print money the way we did during the pandemic, you're going to end up with inflation. So what we need to do is unleash the economy so that we can reduce. I'm the only person on this stage that signed the Americans for Tax Reform tax pledge that I would not increase taxes, ever sign a law to increase taxes, because that's how you reinvigorate the economy, is by decreasing taxes, letting people invest back in their businesses, and then unleashing the regulatory demands that happens on many businesses. And I think beginning to provide tax subsidies and otherwise so that we can put money back into our economy and back on the kitchen tables so that families don't have to work two jobs to make the same money.
Mr. Giles, again, the economy, 2% expansion on track now for the seventh straight quarter. No big deal. Is inflation still more important than that?
Well, when inflation is greater than, you know, like 2%, we're getting inflation at 7%, we're printing money, we're making regulations that are hurting our businesses, like the pipeline, the XL pipeline coming down through, not drilling for our oil, because the oil, fuel, gasoline is what drives our economy. We need to get the prices back down. And it's 2% is like, you know, look at what's going on. Are you paying only 2% more when you go to the grocery store? No, you're paying nearly double. And same with gasoline, at least a minimum of 50% more. So it's 2%, you know, it's one of those situations where, okay, we're going to make gross national profit increase 1%. So when you get to 2, it sounds good. Or we're going to raise inflation to 11% when it comes down to 7. Oh, that sounds good. And when the gasoline goes up to $5 a gallon, comes down to $3 a gallon. Boy, look at how much we saved. It's a hock of junk.
All right.
It's not right.
Okay. All right. We got you. Mr. Cooper, what do you make of this?
I mean, what do I make of it? I honestly make it that the three other people on this stage haven't the foggiest idea what the economy or most of the people in this district are facing. Yes, the economy has been growing on record pace at 2+ per clip as we've gone back for the longest time in history. But that is far outweighed by inflation. It's far outweighed by reckless spending that's devalued our currency. When we talk about what's affecting the people in this district, and really across America, it is actually the decline of your standard of living. So, and what I mean by that is the devaluation of your currency been close to 30% in the last 3 to 4 years. You can buy less with the same $5 that you started with 3 years ago. That's what he was trying to get at. Inflation year over year over year, month over month, is close to 19 or 20% from the beginning of the Biden administration. While yes, we can say that the economy, the GDP, has grown at a certain clip for a record period of time, the effects on our society is not revealed or not revisited per se, like the way that inflation is affecting them, the way that bad energy policy has affected them. Everything that we buy today, including my business, is affected by reckless spending policy and reckless energy policy. And all of those things combined have been the dismantling of the American dream and led to the inability to afford homes or move forward in our lives and start lives as the next generation comes forward.
Mr. Davison, as a congressman, what would you do to fight, let's keep it to inflation, to fight inflation? What do you do?
Well, I was listening to the 2% increase or
yes.
expansion. Well, 2% increase or expansion after 4 years of hell. You've taken us through hell. You've taken our energy away, our cheap energy, causing the price of everything to go up. You've assigned and authorized all of these trillion-dollar bills saying that you're going to reduce inflation, and it's caused life for many Americans to be unbearable, and many people are living on their credit card right now. So that 2% expansion is not the blue-collar jobs. It's not the co-worker. It's not the truck driver. That expansion was the expansion of the government. Those are government jobs, and it's just in time now for the 2024 election, and it's not going to work. What I would like to do is make energy cheap again, to go back into tapping into the power that we have under our feet, and that is our energy and oil, and that's going to make life cheaper.
Follow-up question, please.
Yeah, the two things I didn't hear here is, number one, we need to drill and be dependent on our own oil and not importing. And number two is the border.
I just said
the biggest consumption, yes, the biggest consumption that is taking up monies in the state is the millions coming across the border, the crime, the drugs, the weight of that those types of consumers that aren't paying taxes onto the economy, and that's a huge source of the inflation and also the drag on our economy.
Well, and that's an interesting point, and I want to kind of piggyback that with what we're talking about regarding the economy. Mr. Giles, we'll start with you and immigration here. There is an argument that immigration brings growth, brings more people here, population growth. You've got more people working, more people spending, more people consuming, and that's one of the reasons why that 2% number is there. How do you respond to that?
I think that's full of nothingness, okay? Illegal is illegal. We've heard that before from one of our sheriffs. But anybody that crosses our border not through a port of entry is taking advantage of our system. They know how to step in and say, oh, we're going to want asylum, or we're just going to sneak by. But some of the biggest things we got a problem with is we need to close that border, not for 5,000 people a day, but for zero people crossing the border. We got to stop the drugs coming in. We got to stop the trafficking of people, whether it be children or adults coming in. You got to stop the illegal guns. I spent 22 years working in Saudi Arabia. I know that some of the people coming across that border do not have our best interest in mind. We can talk about that if you like. But it's when it comes to the border, nothing good is coming out of that. They're taking advantage of our systems, taking advantage of our schools, the illegal immigration people you're talking about. They want a free lunch. If we go back to when America became a country in 1776, we were a small set of farmers with flintlock, old muskets, rifles, and we defeated the largest country in the world and got our freedom. Other people in other countries can do the exact same thing, but they don't really want to when they got a free carrot sitting just across the border. Let's go get the free carrot. We should be helping them, if anything at all, to get their country free. And maybe they can adopt one of these and be the same way and copy it.
Okay.
But if they're that lazy that they don't want to do it, why should I pay for their meal? Why should you pay? Why should anybody in our society pay for this stuff?
Okay, time is up, sir. Thank you. Mr. Davison, I just heard that nothing good comes from the border, people crossing the border.
Well, absolutely. I knock on doors, and I talk to people in our district quite often. And I believe Hispanics make up a majority of the population here. And a lot of the families have relatives who came in the right way. They are really hurt and upset that this country have taken them through the hard process and made them pay that and wait all in line and letting these people across the border for free. But here's what's hurting the American people. The open border is a great concern. And it hurts lower income people first, and it takes away their jobs. So I would be in full support of a moratorium on all immigration right now until we get this thing settled, until we come up with a process and a true immigration plan, is that we'll put a hold on that for now and make sure that we get these criminals and illegals out of the country to make sure that we focus on the needs of Americans. And that's what I would do in Congress.
All right, Mr. Cooper, as far as immigration is concerned, a full stop on all immigrants, I'm hearing. I'm also, again, that other side of the argument is you got folks here that are working, spending, contributing. Is there a way to circle that square?
I don't think you really circle any square, but I think when you have an intelligent conversation about the border, you can look at the border and you can tie it to almost every problem facing Americans today, including Arizonans. You can tie it to the economy, you can tie it to jobs, you can tie it to inflation, you can tie it to all of the rest of those things. The truth is that we have to close no man's land, and no man's land is the area in between our ports of entry. Then we have to secure and support our ports of entry to make sure that the people that are coming here legally are getting the support and are being vetted properly so that they are not coming over here to cause trauma, danger, or crime in our communities. And I would say that all of the things that have happened between now and then, the people that have come through our border while it was opened, the illegal immigrants that have come across here, while the majority of them are looking for a better life, and I completely understand that, the job of the federal government and each state's government is to protect their citizens, to make sure that the livelihoods and the foundation that we built our structure, our system on, is protected. And it is not protected when all of your social safety nets are being eaten up by people that did not pay into that system. You said that a lot of these people coming over are feeding into the jobs market, but factually, they're not. People that come across the border illegal can't get jobs. They're in a position where they have to figure out how to pay for their family, which leads to more crime. If I was without job, I would do just about anything to feed my third and fourth grader at home. While it's a very complicated issue, the very first thing is to close that border and then vet and verify the people coming across.
Mr. Davison.
Yeah, well, I would hate to think that anybody here who has a business is hiring illegals. We don't want to see that. But they are being subsidized with
Did you
money.
Want to clarify that?
Huh? I'm just asking a question.
Okay.
When they're receiving thousands of dollars a month to subsidize for their rent and to subsidize for their housing, they don't need to work. But he was saying that he would do more vetting at the border. But here's what it is. Americans want the border closed. And we have a vetting process in this country, and it's called immigration. And that's where people need to go to be vetted. We're not going to vet them at the border. We want the border closed, point blank.
Dr. Jasser.
Yeah, I can't tell you how important this issue is, and this is one of the reasons I'm running, is I'm the son of Syrian immigrants that got asylum here, political asylum, after escaping a dictatorship in Syria in the mid-60s. So I understand what immigration is, and I'm the one most suited on this stage to begin to rebrand a policy for conservatives that is pro-immigration, but yet is not pro-illegal immigration, which is the problem right now with the far-left radicalization of the Democratic Party that is basically allowing a hemorrhage border to allow millions in. I'm the only one on this stage with a 8-point plan about immigration. You can go to z4az.com and look at our plan, and that basically calls for sealing the border. You don't plug an artery by plugging half of it. You either plug it or you continue to hemorrhage. Second, people get asylum before they come in, not after, like my parents asked for it before, and then they got it after they got here. And at the end of the day, we also need to end sanctuary cities. Greg Stanton, who's been a lifetime politician, supported sanctuary cities in Phoenix, which is illegality and is lawlessness. We need to stop the drugs coming in, and there are many other things we can do to protect. We need to vet people before they come in so that they come in to America because they want to be part of our social contract and they love Americanism, which is something we're not doing. By the way, we've been talking about Hispanic population. The vast majority coming across the border are from Africa and in China and elsewhere. This is not about Mexico. It's really about lawlessness at the border.
Follow-up question here for all of you, Mr. Giles.
Before you do that,
okay,
I would
please.
Like to respond.
Please.
Zudi pointed out that none of us are qualified to speak on the border. In fact, and when you
That's
go...
That's a mischaracterization.
In fact, when you go look at his website, you will just see a regurgitation of the points that all the rest of us have made for the last 3 years while we fought for this district. It's great that Zudi wants to drive down from somewhere else to represent people that he doesn't know in a district he doesn't know, but the fact remains, the very first thing we have to do is secure the border. That's, and while he stands here or sits here and regurgitates what the rest of us have already said, the truth
is that's patently dishonest.
Oh, all right, Dr. Jasser, respond then.
It's patently dishonest. I've been fighting for this district in Tempe and in Mesa against radical Islamist groups, against Muslim Brotherhood groups. Rashida Tlaib came to raise money for Students for Justice in Palestine, and I was the only one on this stage that actually protested the fact that Stanton didn't condemn her in Congress and that she shouldn't have been allowed to raise money for an organization who on its website basically called for raising money for Hamas after October 7. It's absurd that he can make these types of characterizations, not be held accountable because it might make him feel good to spew lies, but it's just not the reality.
Mr. Davison, do you have a response?
Well, I would just wanted to say that a part of his vetting process was vetting at the border. It wasn't a vetting before they got here. It was vetting at the border, and we don't want that. The people want the border closed and send them through immigration if that's what they want to do.
Before they cross.
Yes. All right. I wanted to get to this because there was a recently rejected bipartisan immigration plan. We all know about it there on Capitol Hill, and it was rejected because President Trump apparently urged his Republican colleagues not to pass it in order not to give President Biden a legislative victory. And that was the reason that, for the most part, that bipartisan bill that addressed border concerns, Mr. Giles, we'll start with you, did not make it. Would you have voted for that, regardless of what former President Trump wanted?
No, that's absolutely no. I'm not going to vote to say we can allow 5,000 people to come in every day illegally across the border, carrying whatever. I don't care. It's a no. It's a zero is where we got to be. You cross legally through a port of entry, or you don't cross.
All right, Mr. Cooper.
If I could advise President Trump or President Biden, yep, say, call out our military. This is an invasion. Put a soldier elbow to elbow all across that entire border and say nobody crosses.
Mr. Cooper, would you have voted for this?
To be honest with you, you're asking me a hypothetical. I would suggest that we do need to move things forward. I think that the idea that we had some wins in that bill are very positive, some things that we really should have considered. But the big drawback, especially from the conservative side, is that it's still allowed 5,000 people a day. And I don't think that anybody in this district, or really across the country, thinks that it's a good idea to have 5,000 people coming across the border illegally, overwhelming our border patrol, border security, not allowing them to do their job, which masks trafficking. It masks drug trafficking, child trafficking, weapons trafficking. We're basically, by proxy, feeding through our federal government tax dollars into the cartel's hands by allowing anybody coming across our border unvetted and unsecured.
Question though,
sure.
I mean, are you sacrificing the good for the perfect? Was this not a step in the right direction?
Well, and that's a great question, and I think we can have discussions about a couple of other topics that talk about the same thing, which is the inactivity in Congress, the stalemate in Congress. Yeah, I think that we do have to look at some things, and we have to look at them from a perspective of how do we move forward, what's in the best interest of the people in this district. So, yeah, we should take some wins where we can get them, because cutting off our nose to spite our face is how we got here.
Dr. Giles, you were motioning over there?
Yeah, I was saying,
I'm sorry.
If there's compromise, we've been doing this for 50-some, 60, 70 years now, and look at the situation we're in. We need to get some people in Congress that are going to put their foot down and say, no, we got to stop this. You got to stop printing the money. You got to stop zero people crossing that border. You got to stop, come back to the values that have made this country the greatest country in the world. Stop snubbing your nose at them.
Dr. Jasser.
Yeah, I'm sorry, but it is a sham to call that a bipartisan bill. And I think some of the squishiness you've heard from Kelly Cooper demonstrates the type of leadership he will not have when he's a congressman, because, you know, at the end of the day, it's not just the 5,000. None of the points that I mentioned were enacted. All of that bill, endorsed, by the way, mainly by Kyrsten Sinema, who basically has been pretty far to the left, as far as I'm concerned, on most of these issues. It's not bipartisan. There are a few Republicans that might have been on board, but it really just threw more resources at what's happening. It doesn't seal the border. It doesn't cause them to have asylum before they come across. It doesn't stop the hemorrhaging that's happening. All of the solutions that we need to actually say you solve the border crisis aren't part of this bill. So if you read Senator Lee's response to it and others, it tells you that the reality is, transparently, this did not solve any of the problems, and it was a scam, and a sham to call it a bipartisan bill.
Okay, Mr. Davison, it was a bipartisan bill. There was Republican support for this. Would you have supported this?
Well, I love President Donald Trump, but I don't think he got a full chance to read the bill. The bill was not truly a bipartisan bill, and it pretty much gave the Democrats everything they wanted. We really need people in Congress who are strong, who are going to stand on their issues. You want to close the border? Well, then let us get a single bill that focuses on the border without all of the extra stuff in it. 5,000 more people? You mean to tell me that 30 million people aren't enough? One in that 5,000, if one in that 5,000 murdered someone or harmed someone in a car accident, how do we console that family? How do we answer for that one in the 5,000?
Yeah, the nurse.
We want to close the border, and we want to have people in Congress who will stand up for single bills. No more omnibus bills, no more extra pork, no more super bills. One bill, and that's what I'm all about.
All right, we've got to keep things moving here, and I want to get to Ukraine, and I know you were very vocal about your opposition to any U.S. aid to Ukraine. What about aid for Israel? What about aid for Taiwan? What about foreign policy?
I love Israel. The foreign policy of President Donald Trump was immaculate. I believe he had the best foreign policy we have seen in a very long time. We saw the end of the Abraham Accord when Biden came in, where he had those Arab nations coming together, and they kept the peace. But when Biden came in, there was war and division. So President Donald Trump's foreign policies was great. He took the little rocket man and stopped him from shooting rockets, and there was peace around the world, no wars. He ended all of them. So what I would like to see is that America focuses on what's happening inside of America, and that's it. Love Israel. And I believe they had a right to defend themselves against Hamas. But when Iran began to attack them, and I wasn't in support of sending them money with Hamas, but I'm in support of sending them money to help them fight against Iran, because now it's a whole different type of war.
All right, Mr. Giles, as far as foreign policy is concerned, there you go. I knew you were going to hold that up. But as far as foreign policy is concerned and your position, what would you do with Ukraine? What would you do with Israel? What would you do with Taiwan?
Ukraine, we've sent them a bunch of money already. The only people that are profiting from this sending money to Ukraine is Putin and our military machine. As far as Taiwan, they're on a border real close to China. They've been threatened on it. Took care of Rocket Man. He can take care, and President Xi. Trump was meeting with him. There were no wars going on. What was the third one you said?
Taiwan, Israel, and Ukraine.
Well, Israel is God's chosen people. Don't ever speak bad to Israel, or you'll be condemned. Just don't do that kind of stuff. We need to, and if we stop sending support to Israel, there's enough Jewish people here that could send money directly to them to take care of it all the way. But we need to take care of our Americans first.
Dr. Jasser, foreign policy, and again, we just had Vice President Mike Pence today said that Putin will attack a NATO country if Ukraine loses.
So listen, the current doctrine, every administration has a doctrine. And, if you look at the Biden administration, their don't doctrine, which is basically he tells Iran don't, and somehow that's a deterrent. I was on the U.S. Commission into National Religious Freedom, appointed by Senator McConnell through Senator Kyle, and I can tell you that I've been to those countries, many of them, and been across the table after the Arab Awakening, and deterrence works when they know you mean it. And this is the type of president we need. This is why we didn't have any wars under President Trump, because they knew he meant it when he was talking about it. Now, when you talk about Ukraine, obviously, even Matt Gaetz has talked about the fact that we need to have that balanced with reductions either in spending or paid more so through NATO. And I think this is the issue, is that the United States should not bear the brunt of the entire funding of things that are in NATO's interest. Other NATO countries need to do that. So it's not a binary choice, either you fund it or you don't. American people, I've talked to folks door to door, and they will tell you that our economy, our families come first. And yes, if we're going to be helping Ukraine, there is a deterrence effect to Russia's further agenda. Also, however, we can't compare that to Israel. Israel not only has an existential threat, they were invaded to the tune of 50 times what happened to us on 9/11. And nobody questioned what we needed to do in Afghanistan, and they have to do it right across their border into Gaza to decimate Hamas to make sure that never happens again.
Mr. Cooper, foreign policy, what would you support on Capitol Hill?
Well, so the three countries that you brought up, Israel, Ukraine, and Taiwan, and I know that maybe we have a doctrine that doesn't call Taiwan a country, but I believe that they are their own independent people. I think the first thing they have to say that it's America first. Everything that we do, we have to consider all of our Americans first. I think after that, when we talk about each of these individual countries, Israel was directly attacked on October 7th to the tune of tenfold what happened in America.
It's more than 10.
It is okay, and it is something that we should do to support them in their fight for their survival. I don't think that's a question. From Ukraine's perspective, I think you hit on it right off the bat. If Ukraine fails, Russia will attack a UN nation. And there is no question about that. Taiwan needs our support as China is threatening and saber-rattling right across their border. But all of those things require that we have accountability and clarity and transparency in the money that's being sent anywhere. And that money doesn't need to always come from us. It can come from the allies that we have in Europe, in Asia, that can help support those fights.
Mr. Davis.
Okay, I'm glad I heard that. Because we have those European nations that are right out there in their backyard, they should be supporting and putting more of the money up. But I need clarity from both Doc and Cooper. Are they for sending money to Ukraine or are they not for sending money to Ukraine? I didn't hear a clear answer.
All right, Dr. Jasser, yay or nay?
It's not a binary choice. If we're going to decrease, I don't think you turn off a spigot immediately to zero. That doesn't make any sense because, yes, we need to stop sending as much as we have and let NATO send a lot more of the proportional amount. But it is in our interest to make sure that Ukraine is able to have some type of fight against Russia. And that will then prevent them expanding into Estonia, into other countries in the Eastern, what used to be the Eastern Bloc countries. So listen, it's just like if we remove the troops from the DMZ, the best thing to the American economy is what's happening in South Korea. So that little investment that we have, that we put, whether it's foreign aid or into our military budget, has a significant impact on helping secure our own country.
Mr. Cooper, respond to Mr. Davison's question.
Yeah, I mean, I think that exactly what we're talking about is the transition from us financially supporting Ukraine to their local allies and local support in Europe is exactly what we should be doing. That transition period doesn't happen like that. We cannot abandon our allies. We never can abandon our allies overseas because they advance the cause of American freedom around the world. The removal of us from any of those places has been demonstrated repeatedly through history, and the result is always bad. So while we shouldn't be spending as much money as we're spending there, we should be transitioning that over to the European countries to defend them. We also have to look at transparency and accountability in any money, any taxpayer money that we're sending anywhere.
Dave, Mr. Giles, respond to Mr. Davison's question. Would you send any money to these allies?
I'd whittle it down. It's been discussed. You got to whittle it down. But the Americans have got to come first. When I see, we're going to put something into supporting the American people, the homeless people, our veterans, the sick, the elderly, we got to take care of our own first and secure the border. That first. And then we can, the extras we have, we can send overseas to help. That's where aid can come in. As a point of interest.
Yes.
Recently, over 350 missiles, rockets, and drones attacked Israel. What do you suppose would happen if Israel sent over 350 drones into Tehran at once?
Mr. Davis.
Well, here's something that's a major difference between my Cooper and the doctor and myself. I'm for ending the funding to Ukraine. And here's one of the reasons why. We haven't seen our president nor the nations, the European nations, come together and try something called diplomacy. I believe that the Bank of America should be closed for this war, and it could have been ended a long time ago if they had just been diplomatic and sat down at the table and stopped the wasting of money and the wasting of lives. I want to focus on the American people first. We have a border crisis that has never been seen before in any country, and I want to take those resources and put them at the border.
All right, gentlemen, again, I want to make sure we get to abortion. It's a major topic of conversation here in the country, and it certainly is in your particular district. Mr. Cooper, we'll start with you. Should Congress either codify abortion rights or make abortion illegal? Should Congress have a statute that says as much?
Yeah, it's a great question, Ted, and it is running through our district, through our state, through our country. It's been for a long period of time used to divide people. This issue is very clear. It does not belong at the federal level. I will not vote for any legislation either way because the people of Arizona deserve to decide through their legislature what is appropriate for them. And I've been clear from the beginning, from my campaign last cycle through my campaign this cycle, my stance on this has not changed. The people of Arizona need to decide what that is, and 70 plus percent of the people here in Arizona believe that there should be reasonable restrictions. We are all rational people and can have rational conversations about what that is, but the answer is not all the way up to the moment of birth, and it's not none ever. And that is a clear distinction between Pastor Jerome and myself. And frankly, I haven't heard the answer from either of the other two candidates on this stage.
Let's try to get an answer from Dr. Jasser.
I've been taking care of patients in primary care for over 30 years and also a medical ethicist. And I can tell you that I'm pro-life, with the exceptions of rape, incest, and the life of the mother. And I've been that way for my entire medical practice career. And I will tell you, though, that when it comes to federal legislation, I'll disagree with Cooper. The Roe versus Wade removed what was constraints before, but I still think that it allows a federalization of that, and I would be in favor of a 15-week limit on abortion federally, and I would vote for that, because I think that's where the sentiment of the nation is, and the current holder of our seat, Congressman Stanton, has never been pushed to say where he stands on this issue, as far as when does life become infanticide, and the Declaration and our Constitution guarantee life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and life is part of that. And every day of my career, I have dealt with families on life issues, and it's precious to me, and it's something that I've dedicated, and why patients trust me to take care of them.
Mr. Giles, what should Congress do, if anything, regarding abortion?
It's not a federal issue. The 14th Amendment says it goes back to the states or the people. Anything that is specified in here or denied in here reverts back to the states or the people. So it's a mute issue. I personally believe life begins at conception. And biblically speaking, you know, unless the life of the mother is in jeopardy, because it's biblical, if you let the mother die and save the baby doesn't have anybody to take care of it, it eventually dies and you lose them both. If you save the mother, she has the possibility of having another baby and living. So at least one of them would live. But it's not a federal issue. It reverts back to the states.
Mr. Davison, is it a federal issue? Should you be addressing this if you were elected?
Well, it could be a federal issue, like it was a federal issue back with Roe v. Wade. But if I had the opportunity to vote for or against abortion, I would vote against abortion. I'm pro-life. I believe life begins at conception. I believe the zinc spark answers that. When the zinc spark and the spirit of life enters the fertilized egg. But if the life of the mother is in jeopardy, well, then we have the good doctor who'll see about that with their patient. But I do believe that there is a greater plan, that there's something more diabolical behind the abortion stuff. And it has to do with my race and Hispanics.
Explain, please.
Well, Margaret Sanger was a devout racist, and she was a KKK member. She was supported by Bill Gates' father, who started IBM. They both pushed for abortions in the black community to get rid of the colored weeds. So with that plan, abortion stopped black people from populating in America. We only make up 12% in the country, and Hispanics only make up 18%. So the plan of genocide against blacks is tied to Planned Parenthood. And there's no way I am ever going to vote against my people or any people. We need to learn to get back to giving these young ladies counseling and giving them support during their pregnancy.
Okay, we understand how you would vote, but would you support something along that? Would you support Congress doing something about abortion, or do you agree with the Supreme Court and with some of our other guests here that it should go back to the states and Congress should leave it alone?
I absolutely agree. I agree that when it went back to the states should deal with it on a state level.
All right, gentlemen, again, we're running out of time here, but I want to make sure I've heard, we've had a good debate here so far. We've also had divergent opinions, which is great to see and great to hear, and there certainly would be, provided whoever winds up the candidate and facing the incumbent, the Democratic incumbent. That being said, Sir Giles, we'll start with you. Compromise, the concept of compromise, what does it mean to you?
It kind of means like giving in, giving up, not sticking to your guns. You're not keeping your honor. Compromise. It's gotten us into this trouble. That's why I say I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. We send people to Washington, and we got to compromise on this, and we got to compromise on that. And we're down a rabbit hole that we, We got to stop compromising and put our feet down and get some backbone in here and learn how to say no.
All right. I want to keep these relatively short. Mr. Cooper, compromise. What does the concept mean to you?
Well, compromise is two folks coming together with maybe differing opinions and finding what rationally they can both live with. And I think that we're missing a lot of that in both our state house and our federal government. I believe that the people in Arizona and the people across the country are looking for somebody that can bring people together to find what is most beneficial to the most people to make sure that we move our America forward. And I think that there is no other way to perceive compromise.
Dr. Jasser?
I'm going to give you two answers. One is, as a medical ethicist, my expertise has been in mediating with families on compromise to find where they can move forward in the care of their family member and their patient. The second is in politics. Ronald Reagan talked about the fact that you should, if you have 80% agreement and 20% disagreement, you want to be your 80% friend versus the 20% enemy. And that's how we move forward, as we find areas of 80% agreement.
You get to wrap it up, Mr. Davidson.
Well, thank you so very much. I'm excited. We had a great time.
Well, I'm not for closing statements.
Oh, okay. This is not closing?
I need your compromise.
Oh, this ain't closing.
No, right.
Okay.
Not yet.
All right. Well, listen, compromise is good, but when you have two opposing diametrics, right? You have light versus darkness. There's never a compromise there. You have oil and water. They can't blend. And I believe that the Democrat Party right now is on the verge of bringing Marxism and socialism. There's no way I can come to the table with this, because it's anti-American and it's anti-people. It's anti-America.
All right, gentlemen, that is it. Thank you so much, candidates. It's now time for closing statements. And going in alphabetical order, we start with Kelly Cooper.
Yeah, so great. Thank you very much, Ted. I appreciate being out here. I wanted to thank all the people that are watching and paying attention. I specifically want to say thank you to my wife, Erin, and my son and daughter, Mason and Kennedy, for their participation in my run last cycle, where I won the nomination, and continuing on in our fight for the people of this district as we move forward. You see, I believe that there's been a steady and consistent dismantling of the American dream, whether it's been in the devaluation of our currency, meaning that your standard of living has decreased year over year to the tune of $18,000 more in expenses. Whether it's bad energy policy that's driven up not only the price of your gas, but everything else you buy has gone up as a result. That has led to unaffordable housing and the destruction or the dismantling of the American dream. And not only our generation, but the next generation needs somebody that's going to stand up, fight for them, and I am your candidate that has the background and experience to be able to do that. So please support and help me by visiting kellycooperarizona.com. Thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you.
And thank you. And now the closing statement from Jerome Davison.
Oh, finally get to it.
There you go.
I got there a little bit early. Hey, everybody in Arizona, I want you to know I love you. I'm praying for you and that I am the fighter for you. I am the candidate that is tailor-made for such a time as this. And I'm going to get in there and fight to lower the price of gas, to lower the cost of food. No one should have to battle and choose between a six-pack of drumsticks or an eight-pack of top ramen. But a lot of Americans are struggling at the bottom of the barrel, and I want to get you back on top. And that's why I'm asking for your support in this race. This is detrimental. We are at a key moment. And if you have been praying about the spiritual situations and the spiritual battles that we've been in, I want you to consider this question. Which one of us is the answer to your prayers? I'm Jerome Davison. I want you to go to my website. I want you on my team. Let's make some phone calls, knock doors, and let's pray for each other. Let's love each other again. But God bless you.
Thank you very much. And for our next closing statement, we go to Dave Giles.
Yeah, I want to ask for your vote and your support in my campaign, because I want to bring wisdom to Arizona and bring wisdom to Congress. My parents raised me Christian, patriotic. I told you about my father, you know, dropping out of eighth grade to fight in World War II. They were honored on their 50th wedding anniversary by a letter from President Bush and the Pope John Paul II. I continue to learn and continue to expand my experiences. Have been working for NYSEC in New York. Then I worked for Saudi Arabia, the largest oil company in the world. And then I came back and worked for a bit at Wells Fargo, and now I have a federal firearms license. I have a Bachelor of Science in Electrical Engineering degree, where I used to design these things, you know, 20 years ago when they were on the satellite. I have an MBA for business. I know how to run a domestic business, international business. I had over 10,000 people working for me in Saudi Arabia. I came back and got my pilot's license. So I have multiple degrees. I tell you this so that you know I'm technically competent, business-oriented, and theology supported. I will represent and bring wisdom to Congress, which is desperately needed.
All right, sir, we have to stop you right there. And a closing statement now from Dr. Zudi Jasser.
Thank you. We've talked a lot about the problems today, and I can tell you that coming from a family that came to this country to be able to practice our faith and speak freely like we could nowhere else in the world, America is a place of hope. America is a place of unity, and that we need leadership, real leadership, and we can be that shining city on a hill. But we need leaders that understand what families are feeling, understand the reality of the precipice that the Biden-Stanton rubber stamp have led us to, and to bring us back from that threshold. And ultimately, I can do that. I've walked towards the fire for our communities, for our district, and I've walked and demonstrated that I can succeed in representing the interests of this country and defending it and being a fighter for our communities. So join me in this movement. It's a movement, not just a campaign, to bring back American values and unite our district and unite who we are. Come to our website, z4az.com, to help us build a campaign to succeed and defeat Greg Stanton. And I can do that and go toe-to-toe with him and defeat him and send him home into retirement.
Thank you very much, and thanks again to all of our candidates. And thank you for watching tonight's debate. Our next scheduled Arizona Horizon debate will be Thursday, April 25th, as we hear from candidates running for the Republican primary for Arizona's 6th Congressional District. That's Thursday, April 25th at 5 p.m. and 10 p.m. on Arizona Horizon. And you can watch all of our shows live on ArizonaPBS.org or streamed live on YouTube and Facebook. That's it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thank you so much for joining us. You have a great evening.